is like one of the beans are one of the most, you know, one of the foods that has the most science behind it as far as longevity, and then actually helps reverse diabetes. It's actually good for, even endocrinologists that don't know anything about nutrition, they know that beans are good for diabetes, because there are studies that show more beans, the better off you are. So, right. And then if you're just on metformin and your A1C is 5.6, you're technically not even in the pre-diabetes range. But what she's saying is that if you stop the metformin, the A1C, metformin is usually good for about a 1% drop in A1C. So if you stopped the metformin, your A1C would probably go from 5.6 to 6.6. And so then anything 6.5% and above is considered diabetes. And so that's what she's saying. And so it might, as long as it's not causing you any side effects, you might consider staying on it for a little while longer. And then you can talk to her about going off. And then technically you would be considered diabetes in remission if you go 3 months off all medication, the diabetes medication, I guess in which case it's just metformin for you. So once you've been off metformin for 3 months and you have an A1C of below 6.5, that would be diabetes in remission. But ideally you'd want your A1C to be 5.6% or less, it is right now on no metformin, and then you'd be diabetes in remission.
Right. And that brings me to another part of the metformin question. We were talking about bowel movement. I know a while back you said if we didn't go in the toilet or something, or when we took bowel movement, it would, like if we did it out in the field, it would look like cow.
Yeah, cow. Kind of a soft formed pile on the ground is what a normal stool should look like. Yeah.
Okay, and that's what it should still look like. So say yours is, it's fine, because mine's, I don't consider it diarrhea, but he's thinking it might be diarrhea, but I don't. It's just the loose bowels. It's not hard to do or anything.
Yeah, as long as it's not watery. That watery would be diarrhea, but a soft formed pile on the ground would be considered a normal stool. So people that have, put out hard stools, like a formed log, that's actually abnormal. That's actually, means you're not getting enough fiber or enough water or things like that.
Because I know mine in the past have been, but they haven't been for quite a while. So I'm good then. Okay.
Yeah, and then as far as your weight, as long as your BMI is not below 19, then you're
it's
fine.
It's not. I'm down to, my scales, I say I weigh 153. Her scales say 157. The doctor's scales.
Yeah.
I don't even think I'm below 25 yet.
153. So what, how tall are you?
5'4", 71. Is that 71? Something like that.
You're 5'4". So that would be 64 inches. So let me figure you out here. I'm getting into a calculator here. Okay, so you're 64 inches. Anyway, you want me to say 154 pounds?
153. It's 153.4, so say 153.
Okay. Oh, I see. It's wanting to do it. Sorry. It's wants the, not in inches, it wants it in feet.
Oh.
Okay, so 5'4", 26. So That's still considered overweight. So 25 to 30.
Yeah, I'm overweight, but not obese. Yay on that part.
Well, why would she say she doesn't want you to be below 150 pounds?
She thinks it'd be too skinny for me.
Oh, well, as long as you're not below 19 on your BMI, it's fine. So a normal BMI is 19 to 24.
Yeah,
you're at 26.
That's what I thought.
So, Mark, you might want to listen to John McDougall about doctor mongering and decisions that doctors make that keep their patients coming back. And I'm not saying your doctor is just trying to keep you from coming back, but, if you don't have some reason to come back and see her, she doesn't necessarily get paid in our current system.
Right.
You know, doctors don't get paid to keep you healthy. They get paid to have you keep coming back for more visits. So I would give some serious thought as to what advice you're taking and maybe get a second opinion from someone who's telling you to be overweight. That is not something that seems to make health-wise sense.
Yeah, it didn't to me either. But, you know, and then she's worried about my triglycerides. She wanted to put me on statin. I said, no, I don't want to wait. Yeah. So, and she's glad for the way I'm eating. So that's something.
And it's okay. I was going to say it's okay to recommend a statin for anyone that has type 2 diabetes. That's the standard of care. So she's not doing anything wrong there. So you know, we don't want to, we're not saying she's doing anything. She doesn't have your best interest in mind necessarily. We don't know the whole story. We're just kind of saying, well, we're just taking your word for it. It's like, okay, your BMI is actually, you have lots of room to go down. You wouldn't have to worry about that. And then the other stuff we talked about.
Yeah. Well, I've been off statin for a year. Mm. And my LDL went up a little bit. But so she is a little worried about that, but we're going to keep an eye on it. So, all right. And then this last thing, I took a lady to the doctor today and he goes, don't I know you? And I asked him if he was doing plant-based. He goes, no, I'm label or whatever. And he goes, the thing about whole food is they eat a lot of potatoes, bread, and pasta is what he said about the whole food plant. Lots of potatoes, but not bread and pasta. He goes, that's the best way to do it.
Well, keep teaching them, Marcia. Yeah. Maybe they'll come around.
They might.
Joan.
Just to comment on our society. Jenny Craig is going out of business because people are dieting with pills. All those diabetic patients that can't get their pills because people are dieting. Now Jenny Craig's out of business.
Oh, wow.
Dorothy said you couldn't get on. Did you try logging off? If you're having trouble with the sound, try logging off and logging back in again. If you logged in early, sometimes there's an issue with the sound. So log out of the room and log back in. That's my thought. Anybody else have any questions or things that they'd like to tell the group?
Could you explain what the nutrients are that you wanted us to get out of Wakame and Dulse?
Sure, we can explain that. Wakame and Dulse are sea vegetables, which these sea vegetables have, Wakame in particular has the most amount of medium and long chain omega-3 fats. So you have short chain omega-3 fats, which are the ones that you get from most of the other sea vegetables and from walnuts and flax seeds. And then they get converted in your body to the moderate and long chain fatty acids. Well, most people are probably able to convert in their own body the small chain to the moderate to the long chain, but there may be a subset of people who have difficulty converting. We don't know who those people are right at this moment. I guess you could, if you were worried about it, you could do DHA, EPA levels or whatever. It's not, they're fairly spendy tests, I think. And so we just don't routinely do those kind of tests. But if you want to be getting the biggest bang for your buck with these moderate and long chain omega-3s, then Wakame is really probably the ideal. The other thing you get from both wakame and dulse is iodine. So we encourage you not to be doing a lot of salt, oil or sugar, maybe SOS free. But if you take that really literally and you cut out all the salt in your diet and you don't have any iodine source, then you could actually become hypothyroid. So you need to get some iodine, and you'll get some iodine from wakame and dulse. Scott, do you have anything to add to that or subtract or whatever?
No, I think you covered it well. And then if you aren't eating those, you could be doing, there's supplement, iodine supplement made from dulse, and there, or kelp granules is what I take, or some of the plant-based milks, if you buy your own milk, they're fortified. They tend to be fortified, sometimes a little bit of iodine, some other things, calcium and vitamin D and things like that. Just like milk is fortified, regular cow's milk is fortified with those things. And dairy has iodine because they use iodine cleaners to when they milk the cows and stuff. So that's how the iodine gets in cow's milk. But of course, we're trying to get people to go to the nut milks instead of the dairy milk for lots of reasons. So, but yeah, it's good. Good review of that.
Thank you. So we don't need any other omega-3 then if we're taking like an inch of wakame and dulse a day then? Is that right?
I think I would take a tablespoon of ground flax seeds. It's called flax meal, or you can buy the seeds and grind them up. So a tablespoon every day.
Well, I have more than that. Is that a problem?
Well, if you have a tablespoon or two, it probably is not a problem. If you have four or five or six, seeds have a high calorie density. And if you're worried about weight, you could have a fair amount of calories from that, maybe. I don't know. One or two tablespoons is probably fine.
And that's then ground.
Ground up.
That's ground. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
And then walnuts, if you're doing a quarter cup of walnuts or you're having some walnuts, you get omega-3s there too.
Right. But this morning you told me, or this afternoon, you said I better, if I want to make sure I get rid of all plaque, not to do any nuts.
Well, so
if I have one walnut, one Brazil nut, and a tablespoon of ground flax, I'm still going to be okay.
That sounds like a good compromise in my mind, and see how things develop over time.
Okay. Thanks a million.
You're welcome. So what are your thoughts with regard to red marine algae or spirulina? Do you have any thoughts on that, Scott? The red marine algae.
I don't know anything about that specifically.
I don't know anything about red marine algae either. And spirulina has been around a long time. There have been some, wasn't there some contamination of spirulina on some products Gregor brought out? So he was not very encouraging of depending on that, but occasionally using it probably is not a problem. That's my thought.
Looking at my notes to see if I had
Scott's looking at this, doing a little research there. We can get back to that as time goes on.
The other thing I'll mention with the omega-3 thing too is about, we taught how Charlie was talking about how some people don't convert the medium or the short chain omega-3 to the medium and long chain as well. What's the more common thing for all of you to kind of understand is that actually what one of the things that blocks the conversion of short chain to medium and long chain omega-3 fatty acids are omega-6 fatty acids. So omega-6 fatty acids are also essential fatty acids that which means we can't get them from, we don't make them ourselves. We have to get them from our diet. And most of the omega-6, even whole plant foods have some omega-6 in them, but very small, much smaller amount. But where the majority of omega-6 fatty acids are in oils, so processed foods and oils, So like if you're going and getting donuts and, you know, and fried foods at, you know, going to McDonald's and things like that, where you're getting fried, you know, French fries and eating donuts and all the processed foods where all the oils are used for cooking all those, making all those foods, those are really high in omega-6 fatty acids. And omega-6 fatty acids are pro-inflammatory. They cause inflammation, whereas omega-3 fatty acids are anti-inflammatory. They reduce inflammation. And so we do need a little bit of omega-6. And again, we do get, so even walnuts and some of the other nuts that have omega-3s also have some omega-6. But the ideal ratio of omega-6 to omega-3 is anywhere from 1 to 1 or 4 to 1. And what the 4 to 1 would be, the 4 would be omega-6. So 4 parts omega-6 to 1 part omega-3. From 4 to 1 down to 1 to 1 is the ideal ratio. And most, the standard American diet is more like 20 to 1 to 30 to 1 to 40 to 1. So way more omega-6 than omega-3. And knowing that I said earlier that omega-6 fatty acids inhibit the short chain omega-3s from converting to the medium and long chain, which is the ones we really want more of, keeping that in mind. So if you're eating a whole food plant-based diet and eliminating those oils and processed foods, then your ratio is going to be going much more ideal. It'll go from that, say, 20 to 30 to 1, maybe all the way down to 4 to 1, 3 to 1, 2 to 1, 1 to 1, down into there. And so you'll convert it much better. So that's one aspect. And then just as another example, people think, oh, well, olive oil is a healthy oil. Well, it has a small amount of omega-3, but it actually has and not a super high amount of omega-6, but it actually, its ratio, olive oil's ratio is 14 to 1. So 14 omega-6 to for every 1 omega-3. So it's not a, you know, if 4 to 1 or less is the ideal ratio, olive oil is not very good because it's 14 to 1 because it's, again, it's a processed food. So yeah, so keep that in mind when you're, so for most people, as long as you're eating mostly whole food plant-based, you're going to get a nice conversion of the short chain fatty acids, omega-3 fatty acids from things like walnuts, chia seeds, flax seeds, like we talked about, into the into that DHA, EPA, which is the long chain, medium and long chain omega-3.
I'd like to go back for a moment. Thanks, Scott, to nutritionfacts.org and answer the question about spirulina. And so I'm gonna take you over to nutritionfacts.org. And we're going to do a quick search on spirulina so you can see how this is done. And under the quick search for spirulina, you can see, oops, you mentioned red algae. He talks about blue-green algae. I looked up the red algae and it's a capsule supplement. I don't know how they make that or how it might be contaminated. But if you look under this, toxin contamination of spirulina supplements. So you may want to listen to this video. There's another one on spirulina here and another one here and here, another update on it, another update. You may want to listen to these if you really have an interest in using spirulina. And that's all I wanted to say. Raw coconut, what about that, is the next question.
Yeah, Lena. sprinkle a little bit on something if you really like it, like, you know, on your oatmeal or whatever, but it's got, you know, it's going to have more saturated fat because it's, coconut has more saturated fat, but you're getting it in its whole plant form, so it's not going to be as harmful as, say, coconut oil. So yeah, we would say don't go too crazy on it because it is really high in fat and calories and saturated fat. But if you're just putting a little bit on, you know, as a garnish or a little bit in something, it's, you're not using it as a food. You're just using it as a flavoring or a garnish. I would say it's fine.
Coconut is one of my downfalls in terms of food addictions, potentially. I love the taste of coconut. And I try to stay away from it most of the time because of the saturated fat. But like Scott says, sprinkle, if you use that word sprinkle, that means you're not eating a lot of that. And if you're able to get by just doing a little sprinkle of that coconut on your food, it's, my mouth is watering just talking about it, but I'm careful not to eat that most of the time. But occasionally it's a fun treat from my thoughts. Oh, you mentioned it because you're so thin and skinny. Well, maybe coconut is okay for you. But if you want to add weight, don't do it with saturated fat. Do it with beans and with lentils and with potatoes and with nuts and other seeds, you know, like maybe some pumpkin seeds or, you know, instead of doing a quarter cup of nuts, maybe you need a half a cup or three quarters of a cup of nuts for the day. So avocado is another good food. And you could sprinkle your salads with olives, real live olives would be the healthiest source rather than raw coconut. Just my thought.
And if that doesn't work, you could even do a little whole grain bread or toast with peanut with a nut butter on it or something, you know, if you're still having a hard time getting enough calories in, you know, to maintain your weight, or even if you're trying to gain a little bit of weight.
I have a question.
Yes, go ahead.
Nikki. So we were talking a moment ago about thyroid, and for reasons I don't know, I was prescribed thyroid when I was a teenager, but things, they did that differently back in those days. And my dad was on it. And I'm classically low thyroid in terms of always real cold, really, really cold. Today is the first day I'm not wearing a turtleneck and fleece. and with an undershirt under it. And I'm tend to run a little bit overweight and super sluggish and all those kinds of things. But when I get tested, they say, well, you're within the whatever, that the test results are okay. But people say, well, you need to go to a naturopathic or functional medicine doctor, and they will give you a clinical trial. And I don't know. And I think I've read that they prescribe differently in the United States and some other countries. So I just wanted to get your thoughts on that.
Yeah, I know we don't, at least I don't know much about naturopathic medicine. So, I mean, we got a brief education on it when I was in PA school. Mm-hmm. I'm sure, I don't know if Dr. Ross got any in medical school, but it's called CAM, which is complementary and alternative medicine. So we kind of got some overview of that. But I know from other patients that, yeah, they do a lot more in-depth testing and things. And I don't know, I think, I guess my opinion on a lot of that sometimes is that they're probably just as guilty of doctor mongering as the traditional allopathic, which is what Charlie and I are, traditionally trained allopathic medicine. So I don't know, but yeah, so I can't speak intelligently on if that's going to be any better or not, because we just go off the TSH, the thyroid stimulating hormone. If it's in the normal range, then the thyroid's doing okay. But I'm sure the naturopathic would have different opinion on that. So, but I can't speak intelligently on that.
You don't see very often that people will do a clinical trial to see if there's benefit. I think that's maybe what they used to do in the 60s and 70s.
Well, I have had patients that have a normal thyroid blood test, and then they still go on thyroid medicine that they were prescribed by their naturopath or whatever. And, and I know they, those of us in the allopathic would say, no, that's not a good idea. And because there's no randomized controlled trials that would show that has benefit and things like that.
What happens to their test results then?
Yeah, I guess they could have a suppressed TSH then, because they're on supplementation. And then because the TSH is your pituitary gland, is basically communicating with your thyroid gland, which sits here in your neck. So the pituitary gland in your brain secretes TSH, which is called thyroid stimulating hormone. So when your circulating thyroid coming out of your thyroid gland here is low, then the TSH in your brain goes high because it's saying, hey, there's not enough thyroid circulating, so we need more thyroid stimulating hormone to tell that thyroid gland to secrete more thyroid hormone. And so that's what we follow the TSH in the brain. So if you have a normal TSH, then you start taking a thyroid supplement, then what that's going to do is make the TSH actually go down, because it's saying, oh, we got more thyroid hormone circulating than we need, and so we need to tell the thyroid to make less. And so it ultimately wouldn't be a good idea, because people that then have too high of a thyroid, then they'll get heart palpitations, they'll have unintended weight loss, get sweaty, feel hot all the time, hair can fall out, things like that. Okay. So that's not a good thing. So it's not good to be too high or too low.
So I can focus on how you talk about getting enough iodine in my diet.
Yeah. So I'd like to share a couple of my two cents worth, Nikki. I don't look for advice on online sites or nutrition sites from anyone or any company that is selling a product, making money from selling a product to a person, to a customer or a patient. I look for my sources for those people who share the evidence-based medicine. And if a decision is made that I need a supplement or I need a pill of some sort, I go and purchase that from some other source, not from the source that's giving me my information. And that's the only issue that I have with naturopathic physicians. It seems like most of the time when people have gone to naturopathic physicians, and I'm not saying they're misdiagnosing or bad people or anything like that, but what I am saying is they have sort of a conflict of interest in my mind, because I don't recall a patient who said, I went to the naturopathic physician, they advised me to go get a prescription at this pharmacy. Instead, they had the medicine, which they sold me. So they have kind of this interest in, they're making an income off of.
I have noticed that with friends of mine.
Have you?
Oh, yeah. There's somebody I drive, sometimes give rides to, who stops at a naturopathic doctor and has to buy all these supplements there.
Yeah,
and that doesn't seem right to me. And then also, I guess I'm biased, but I've been COVID cautious the last few years. But this person, he was refusing to wear a mask, you know, when it was, that's what we were supposed to be doing. I mean, in healthcare setting.
Yeah, and that's a very political issue, this mask issue. And, you know, that really is, I guess, a quagmire. We get sunk into the quicksand with that pretty quickly. But my mind, if someone is selling a product, giving advice and then selling a product, that is problematic.
Yeah, I agree with that.
And so they may even be right, but it still makes it problematic in my mind. If they did special tests and they said, we really think you should take this thyroid medication, they wrote a prescription or told you to go get it somewhere that they weren't personally benefiting economically, I would even go along with that. And I'd say, okay, that makes sense to me. That's just my thought on that. So for you, would you want to do a trial of thyroid? You could kind of say, do you drink coffee? Does it wake you up? Some people drink a cup of coffee to kind of get stimulated in the morning. So if one cup did fine for you and you were doing great, would two cups be better, or three, because you'd have maybe more energy?
I can't really handle coffee because it gets me kind of jittery. So I don't drink coffee.
Okay. So,
but my doctor doesn't have, you know, he just says, well, you know, you're probably depressed, or, you know, but I've had this kind of lifelong, but it seems to be getting worse as I get older, of just being so incredibly cold all the time.
As we age, like for myself, I'm colder now than I used to be when I was 10 years younger. We turn the heat up. We used to live at 69. Now my wife and I are closer to 71 to 72 and sometimes 73. And so there is something, maybe it has to do with the amount of body fat that we have. Maybe it has to do with our circulation or whatever it is, but I'm not sure. I don't necessarily think it's related to psychological reasons that you're feeling this coolness. I think it's not an unusual thing to feel cool. My dad always used to, he was 99. He would always wear this coat and he was always cold, you know, and the older he got, the colder he got, but he kept wearing more clothes and it worked for him. So I'm expecting the same for me, and it may be the same for you, naturally. Just a thought.
Okay, thanks.
But I don't think it's in your head. Anybody else?
I just have a comment to Nikki. I'm always cold. My husband is hot-blooded and I'm cold-blooded? I don't know. But I almost always wear a jacket or long sleeves because I am cold. Because I live in Montana and that is, we've had an extremely cold. But he likes to keep, we have a fireplace and we have a propane heater. And I, you know, I just wear what I feel comfortable wearing. So.
Well, what I do is I have socks filled with flaxseed and I sew the ends on, and I've got about, this is pretty, it's, I call this my addiction. It's pretty extreme. I heat them up in the microwave and I just surround my body with them. I have one around my neck and I have one on my chest, and then I'm covered with a blanket. This is in the living room. And it kind of, it feels very, very odd, like very odd behavior, but that's what I do to keep warm. Or, you know, I mean, if I go on a walk and exercise, I can get warmer for a while.
I'm usually don't sit. I am busy all day long. I might be making cards. I might be working at the bar. Well, that doesn't sound good, but what I do at the bar is I make the beds, I iron the pillowcases, and I do the laundry. I don't work in the bar. I'm not a drinker.
Good clarification.
But anyhow, I mean, I'm pretty busy and I'm 75, so I'm still quite active. And I think it's all the whole food, plant-based eating.
So this was a roundabout discussion about, should you try a trial of thyroid? It is an option that you would have, that you discuss with your doctor. Could I take a really low dose, see if it made a difference in my heat intolerance? But I would monitor it carefully, and I personally wouldn't encourage anyone to take thyroid if they had normal TSH and normal T4. If your values were normal, but they were at the lower end, you know, that may be approaching low thyroid, then I might consider a trial with a patient. But if you're right in the middle or in the high end of thyroid function, probably I wouldn't encourage that. Okay.
You see the question in the chat there? I can comment on that if you want.
Go ahead. I've been talking plenty.
Yeah. So the different diets for different things. And so I think they even came out I think it was a set of, I'm trying to remember it was the American Heart Association. American Heart Association came out saying, you know, that, the best diet for heart health, you know, it's always been like, they always had Dean Ornish's diet, whole food, plant-based as the number one, but then different agencies, different organizations come out with what's the rating the different diets. And so it's more or less a Mediterranean, they can commented on a Mediterranean diet being, you know, good for heart health and whatnot. And then also the DASH diet, which is for the dietary, for stopping hypertension. is for blood pressure, but it's also good, you know, for heart health and different ones. And so I think the thing that when these news organizations and stuff come out, or even American Heart Association, when they come out with different dietary recommendations, one thing that gets lost that they don't really share with the public in these statements is that one of the big criteria that they use to rate diets is how likely people will follow it, how tolerable it would be, not just what the science says. We know that there's, like Charlie, like we talk about in these classes all the time, there's only two studies that have ever shown reversal of the number one killer of heart disease, and it's 100% whole food plant-based diet. That's the only diet that's ever been shown to reverse heart disease, not Mediterranean, not paleo, not any other dietary style. And then, it's just what diet will people follow and things like that. And a good example of that I always like to bring up is with the DASH diet. So when they came out with the DASH diet, a group of doctors sat down and they looked at the science, at the nutritional science on what's going to be the best way to eat to lower blood pressure the most. And what they came up with was a 100% whole food plant-based diet. That's what they came up with. But then, the leader of the group that came out with the DASH diet is a gentleman named Frank Sachs. So Frank Sachs and these other doctors sat down, figured out what the best diet was for lowering blood pressure, and it was a whole food plant-based diet. But then they said, but people aren't going to follow that. It's going to be too strict, you know. So what can we do to the diet? What can we do to a whole food plant-based diet to make it so that more people will follow it, so that, you know, if you think about it, it kind of makes sense. Okay, well, if they don't think very many people will follow that, and not enough people would follow that 100% whole food plant-based diet to lower blood pressure, so what can we add back into the diet to make it more acceptable to more people? Okay, let's add in some chicken, some fish, some kind of lean proteins, and let's add in a little bit of low-fat dairy. And there's the DASH diet is formed. It's mostly plant-based, but has some lean protein and some low-fat dairy. And so now that's how they came up with the DASH diet. So they don't just follow the science. They look at, okay, here's the science, but what can we add back in so that more people will follow it? And I get the reasoning is because, well, then more people will tolerate it. But when they don't divulge all those details, then people think that, well, fish and chicken and low-fat dairy must be healthy then. And so when you really look at it from that aspect, you're like, to me, that's pretty patronizing, because it's like, well, just tell people what the science says and let each individual person decide whether they want to do it or not. So they should be saying, eat 100% whole food plant-based diet if you want the lowest blood pressure, you want to reverse heart disease, all these things, all these chronic conditions. But, you know, but if people can choose whether they want to follow it 100% or not, that's up to each individual person. But I think we sell people short by coming up with these different diets and rating them and things like that. And, because it gives people, well, that must be healthy. Then these foods that are in these diets must be all healthy, and they aren't necessarily.
Yeah. When I got that, it made my blood pressure go up. It just did. It's like,
yeah,
tell us the truth.
Yeah.
And let us decide, instead of them trying to, oh, you're like children, we'll do this for you. Plus, the other thing is, they talk about fad diet, and then they list vegetarian like it's a fad diet.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, it's like, I couldn't believe it. And no wonder everybody's confused. And then you try to tell everybody, you know, to go to whole food plant-based. Well, the doctor said that this is the best, the Mediterranean. Yeah. You know, it's not truthful, and I don't think they should try to dumb it down and assume that, oh, they won't do it.
When it comes to sustainability and looking at diets throughout the world, I understand there are places in the world where people might not be able to follow 100% whole food plant-based diet, because there might be places, you know, really third world countries on the coastline where, you know, if they didn't eat fish, for example, that's like a big staple of their diet, and they might, you know, not get enough food to eat if they didn't eat fish. And so they might need to eat fish. You might not be able to tell them, hey, you can't eat fish. It's, you know, you shouldn't eat fish because it's, you know, not 100% whole food plant-based diet. You know, you have diabetes or heart disease, you probably shouldn't eat the fish. But if the alternative is, you know, starving to death and not getting enough calories. So a lot of the bigger organizations that look at dietary patterns throughout the world and what we should recommend from both from a health standpoint, from a environmental standpoint, from an ethical standpoint, it is mostly plant-based, but like maybe 90-95%. And then there are places in the world where it might not be, you know, feasible again to for everyone to eat the exact same way. And so I understand some of that, you know, makes sense because it's not going to be if one size fits all for every part of the world, for example.
Yeah, I doubt this email went much out of Oregon.
Well, it was on the national news, about the American Heart Association diet, you know, coming out with their list of diets. And they actually had, for heart health, they actually had, you know, low carb diets, keto diets is at the bottom. So the worst, you know, so at least they recognized that because of all the, you know, red and processed meats and high fat dairy and all everything else is with those diets is not going to be good for heart health. So at least they acknowledged that component.
Can I jump in?
Okay, yeah. Joe.
I've been pretty compliant for a little over a month. I think I've been doing pretty well, lost a little bit of weight, you know, feeling better, more regular, you know, all the good stuff. But, you know, I've had a few slips, but boy, the other day I was craving pizza and they were having some at our community center. So it's like, I'm going to have some pizza. And I got cheese, you know, which, you know, I thought, well, that, how bad can that be? It was bad. I mean, my body, I got my gallbladder removed, you know, within the last maybe year, and all the grease, all the cheese, all the gluten, something, there was a revolt. I mean, is that normal? You know, that you eat really well and then you slip up and then, oh my gosh.
You're kind of lucky.
Yeah, with the cheese, because the lactose, you probably don't have the bacteria to digest it very well anymore. So it might, yeah, give you a lot of stomach pain and cramps and diarrhea and bloating.
Oh, everything.
Yeah.
Okay, thanks.
Yeah, you know, it's probably, we don't wish this upon anybody to have a bad reaction to foods that they eat. But you're kind of lucky in a sense because you can see the impact. Your body kind of gets used to being beat up. It gets used to a level of inflammation that's going on chronically in your body. And then you change your diet and the inflammation level goes down. And then you eat a food which is inflammatory. And wow, it says, I don't like this, is what apparently happened with you.
Yeah, I won't be eating that again.
Yeah, so it's pretty obvious you won't. And a lot of people have trouble with that because cheese breaks down into a morphine-like substance. It's called casomorphine. That morphine-like substance lights up your brain and makes you feel good. It's sort of like cocaine. It's the same center. And so cheese has been one of the, and dairy have been one of the more difficult things to set to the side. So, but it sounds like you've been pretty successful and you're just kind of experimenting a little bit with life and learning life lessons.
Like Linda has a hand up.
Linda. I'm gonna say that every now and again I do get a craving for pizza and I go to Papa Murphy's. It's not too far from my house and they kind of know me because one of the employees will pick up my pizza and go to hand it to me and they get this look of panic on their face and somebody else will rush over and say, it's okay, it's okay. She doesn't get cheese on her pizza. I just get all the vegetables put on it. And I learned not to get
the black olives because they are so salty. I die. I need to drink like a gallon of water if I get them. But I just get like onions and extra mushrooms and sometimes artichoke hearts. But that's it. I mean, and it's so funny to see their face when they think they screwed up and forgot to put the cheese on.
That's a good story. We like it. We had pizza this last week. My wife made for the grandkids, and she makes a killer tofu. She takes the tofu, cuts it into cubes, puts some nutritional yeast along with some additional spice, and puts her fingers in it somehow. I don't know. So it makes my mouth water. So she puts the tofu in the air fryer and fries it up that way without any oil. And then that's one ingredient of the pizza. She uses a red sauce, no cheese, of course, makes her own pizza crust, and then adds a bunch of different vegetables. And it really is quite a tasty treat.
Yeah, Papa Murphy's does have non-dairy vegan cheese now, but it's disgusting. So I just skip it.
Yeah, and the vegan cheese has a high quantity of fat in it too, so you got to be careful about that.
Yeah, it's just greasy slime.
Yeah. Anybody else? Someone put TJ's has gluten-free crust in the freezer section. Let's see, cauliflower pizza without cheese or white Alfredo sauce. What about capers? Capers are, I don't know if they have a bunch of salt in them or not. Do you know, Scott, about capers?
I've seen them, yeah, they're usually in a jar, right?
Sure. You know, if you have a small quantity as for a taste, it's probably okay. And I think it is a plant. So I don't think it's a problem. Has anyone ever air fried mushrooms? I think you could do that. We've never tried it that I know of. Let's see, Susan, you want to unmute? Just unmute, like there's a little, there you go.
I was just saying, this bottle of capers has 350 milligrams of sodium in it for one tablespoon.
Yeah, and how many calories is in the tablespoon?
Calories, 5.
Yeah, so you want to try to keep the sodium less than the total number of calories. So if you're going to use it, don't use a full tablespoon. Use a few little capers for a taste treat.
Okay. Yeah.
Anyone else?
Ed's got his hand up. There's Ed, Mary, and Marshall have hands up.
Okay, so who was first? Ed, you want to go first, then Mary, then Marsha.
Yeah, on the subject of pizza, I recently got a job at Papa's Pizza, and one of the perks is we get one free pizza after every shift worked. And I am tested every single night. I love pizza. But I'm hearing that a lot of other people here are eating pizzas. I'm just wondering if there's a more healthy option.
There is a more healthy option. There's a cauliflower crust. Not sure exactly how they make that. And I don't know if your business makes that.
I don't think so.
But if it doesn't, then you really want to try to get a whole grain. crust, which they probably don't make either.
Right. They do gluten-free, and that's about it.
So what you could do is, instead of eating the whole pizza, is take the veggies home with you and the red sauce, and you could, you know, put it in a bowl with some, put it on the potatoes, or put it on whatever you want to put it on by itself, or if you want to use a whole grain bread, and pretend you're making your own pizza that way. I know it's free food, it sounds like, for you.
Yeah.
But the crust, it's sort of like white bread that you're eating with most pizza crusts. It's inflammatory, not the healthiest choice. But if you did it occasionally and you're otherwise healthy, not taking pills, and you don't have any health issues, probably not a problem occasionally.
Okay.
On a regular basis, yeah, you're tested for sure.
Yeah, okay. Because another option is like a big a plate go through the salad bar, which is just mostly lettuce.
Yeah, it's the head lettuce, no less, which doesn't have much greenery to it. It's more water.
Right.
But you do have maybe some options in there. I guess you have tomatoes and you have...
Yeah, like tomatoes and peppers and stuff.
Right. So, you know, that is probably your best choice if you're going to keep getting the free food, whatever you could get out of there. You could ask them, okay, can we get some kale or spinach or whatever it is? You know, those little ones, the baby one, and, you know, it may pick up our business. You know, people are doing more of that if they have space.
Okay.
Just a thought.
Well, maybe I will have a pizza like once a month.
Yeah, there you go. We were back, and it is Mary Ellen.
Well, I just found a more compelling reason to be plant-based and to not eat animal products. I'm doing a research about human trafficking, and I have found that the employees of these massive chicken farms, where they have 300,000 chickens, and the slaughterhouses, the main slaughterhouses, they are taking unaccompanied illegal minors and having them work in these places because they just can't get any decent labor. And the conditions these children are in are just horrific. And the best way we can stop it is to not support those industries. So it just really strengthened my desire to encourage other people to not keep eating animal products. The animals are treated horribly. And now to find out there's minor children also being treated horribly was just a huge revelation to me.
Mary Ellen, thanks for bringing that up. I believe I saw that on CBS News within the last two nights. The kids were down, they were 14 years old. One child was 10 years of age, and they're brought in the middle of the night to clean up these bloody floors and, yeah, it was horrible working condition. They're kept up all night, and then they're supposed to go to school the next day. And the company knew about it, and I don't know what settlement they came to, claiming they're not going to continue to do that, but they need to be hawked. But thanks for bringing that up.
That's why they've been lowering the child working age in places like Tennessee and stuff so that those kids can work there. So keep an eye on the politics. It's disgusting.
Yeah, thank you. Marcia.
Is it? I've heard or read that unless you need to eat gluten-free, you shouldn't really eat that way. Unless you have that disease that you can't eat it.
Scott, go ahead.
Yeah, that's correct. So unless you have celiac disease, Or, I mean, there's, so about 1% of the population is estimated to have celiac disease, which is true gluten allergy. Maybe up to 10% of the population has some gluten sensitivity. And so that, what that means then is the 90% of us should not avoid gluten, because it's a, you know, gluten is part of a healthy whole grain. So, and I actually have a study, a position statement that was review, a meta-analysis reviewing all this, a huge bank of studies that were done on gluten-free diets. And because a lot of people that follow gluten-free diets, it's a lot of process, it's a lot of processed food that they end up eating. And then a lot of times people then unfortunately will not only avoid gluten, but they'll avoid a lot of other whole grains too. And that's not a good thing either, because it's a, you know, those are foods that have a lot of nutrients, really healthy. A lot of studies that show it, they're anti-inflammatory and good for longevity. But the one exception is gluten. For people that have celiac, it actually causes inflammation for those people. So, so yeah, 90% of us should not worry about avoiding gluten.
Okay.
Ken?
Two things. One, gluten is like the most highest protein part of the grain. So it is good to eat it. And in the recipes that I followed in making my own bread, they, all the recipes call for gluten to be added. And gluten, as you all know, makes bread chewy. So to me, it's a good thing. The other question I have is, I missed a little bit of that discussion on children working all night cleaning up slaughter plant. Where was that?
It was throughout the country. There were, I think it was it JBS or J, I don't know what's the company. Do you know, Mary Ellen?
I know there were plants shut down in Ohio. I believe it was either, and also maybe Vermont or West Virginia, but it's happening across the country. And it's being winked at. And our Department of Health and Human Services at the national level is the one placing these children with these mobsters who exploit these children. They don't get their pay. It's slavery.
Who are the children, like, my children of migrants that are need work, their family needs money?
That's part of the story. They will get recruited in a country like Guatemala, and then they will be sent here, and their families have to give up the deed to their property, their farm in Guatemala, to cover the debt for these children until they pay the $15,000 fee. But they get about $6 a day in American wages when they're here, and they never get out of debt. They have done some prosecuting of some of the main labor bosses who've been running this, one part of this operation, and he escaped back to Mexico, and I think he just got arrested trying to get back. So yes, they're trying to better lives for their families, and the families go along with it because, oh, I'll get my child to America, they'll get educated, they'll have a good life. And it's just not the truth.
Did you say there was a program on CBS that
I think was, it was CBS. I watched CBS and CNN. CBS, I think, is where I saw it.
There's several things on YouTube about it. There is a woman who just came forward as a whistleblower, and that's what got me cued in. Her name is Tara Lee Rodas. And just type in anything, and her name will come up. But try just current child trafficking. And I think they call them unaccompanied alien children or something like that, UAC.
Okay, Joan.
It was a 60-minute program that about the mob, but there was a teacher who found chemical burns on children, and they were found in 8 states.
There you go.
The same company was.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Yeah, 60 minutes. Ken, look it up.
Will do.
And to change the subject a little bit, there was another question in the chat about the oxalate vegetables. And so the three that are the highest in oxalates are beet greens, Swiss chard, and spinach. And so you might want to not go too crazy on those, because high oxalates, so oxalates actually block absorption of calcium. And then people that tend to form a lot of calcium kidney stones might want to not go too crazy on the spinach, the Swiss chard, or the beet greens, but all the other green leafies and other vegetables are fairly low in oxalates. And so on the lower side, so shouldn't, you know, do too much problem, you know, no problems with calcium absorption.
So how much is too much? I usually tell people who are kidney stone formers or whatever it might be, maybe a handful of oxalate foods that are high in oxalates a day is probably the upper limit that I would take for myself. I don't have any study to show science connected with how much you can actually eat. I don't think you have to cut it to nothing, but you shouldn't be eating 3 or 4 handfuls of those kind of foods if you're a stone former. A day, that is. 3 or 4 handfuls a day for those of you who are really eating the greens. You know, Dr. Esselstyn, what does he recommend? 6 times a day. And I don't think there's a lot of people who are doing that many, but some people take it literally and are doing a lot.
Charlie, like you, I eat collards every day, and I do that because I need the calcium to fight the muscle loss I have from androgen deprivation therapy. But don't you add quite a bit of spinach to your collards as well? I do, like 3 times a week.
So we buy spinach in one of those containers that's about this big. It's about, 6 to 7 or 8 inches. It's a small one. And Christine and I will have not a full handful. We may have a half a handful, like a half a cup of uncooked spinach with a half a cup of arugula. And then we have about a cup of broccoli. And then she chops up the leaves, collard, one collard leaf, kale leaf, and a charred leaf, so that we have another few cups of, she steams that. So we're eating quite a bit of greens for breakfast.
What was after arugula?
Arugula.
What was after that?
Spinach and arugula and broccoli, 3/4 of a cup to a cup. And then we have, you know, another, about a cup of cooked leaves of a combination of chard and what else? Kale and collard green. It's quite a variety of different green plants, but my mouth is watering because it tastes good. She adds a little balsamic vinegar. There's a little dulse inside of that. Sometimes it's a little wakame that I'm getting used to now. And there's one mushroom that goes along with that. You know, mushroom is has an ingredient. I think it's aromatase-like, or maybe that's what it is. It's not found in any other plant foods. So I've come to learn to like mushrooms. One of those little button or portobello mushrooms we put in the steamer and eat that every day, one a piece, not a lot.
Aromatase inhibitor is what mushrooms
there
have.
There you go. Thank you, yeah. Scott.
Aromatase is an enzyme that converts, produces more estrogen. So people that have breast, women that have breast cancer will take aromatase inhibitors. And so they're very expensive, and that's to help reduce estrogen, circulating estrogen levels for estrogen positive breast cancers. And mushrooms naturally have aromatase inhibitors in them.
Scott, that's super interesting about it having some estrogen, because in the research I've done on things I should eat because I'm fighting prostate cancer, I found it's recommended to have 3 button mushrooms a day for us guys that are we've got the prostate cells stopped because of the deprivation therapy. And we just want to keep it that way so they don't metastasize. So we're recommended from research about prostate nutrition for prostate patients, 3 button mushrooms a day. So I eat mushrooms all the time.
Good.
That's great. Joan.
So I've been eating my greens without any dressing. So I'm curious about the balsamic vinegar. And how much would you put on?
You could put on, I think Gregor recommends, a tablespoon or two.
To like a whole dish or just an individual serving?
We use about a tablespoon with an individual serving that goes on that cup. And they come in different flavors too. My wife found a coconut that our grandkids really like, but their balsamic vinegar is really a tasty treat once you get used to it. And vinegar sounds bad, but it really doesn't have a vinegary taste in my mind.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Yeah, people were commenting about the online summit, the Food Revolution Summit with John and Ocean Robbins. Yeah, I caught quite a bit of it when I could, some of the replays and stuff. And they had a bonus replay, episode 9, this over the weekend. Actually, it was about a little over an hour. I watched that, finished watching that today. But yeah, I thought it was really good. I mean, someone commented they'd like the interviews one-on-one with each provider better, but this was a different format. I think they're both really good. Did anyone else catch that?
Anyone else watch that and find something you wanted to share with the group about it that you thought was a key thing that might encourage them to listen in next year?
Yeah, it's I like it.
Okay, so we'll start with Marcia and then we'll go to KAS. Just unmute first.
I watch it and I see it almost every year. They put on a good program. They always want you to buy the program, but I don't. And they had below, if you scroll down, you could see the speaker. So Dr. Gregor was speaking and a whole bunch, but the whole essence of the whole thing, eat whole foods, plant-based. You won't go wrong if you eat whole foods, plant-based. You got to eat whole food, plant-based.
I wonder where else you get that message, Aaron.
I don't know. I think
Okay, KS.
Hi, it's Karen.
Okay, Karen.
I'm trying to get it changed to say something other than K, but I can't figure out how to do it yet.
Okay.
I listened to the whole thing and because I was sick in bed and I was taking notes and I think it helped because it showed me which things to take for inflammation to reduce it. And I just like the presentation. It's great. It's a good supplement to what you guys do. So that helped a lot.
That's great. We kind of sometimes think of ourselves as a good supplement to what they do. Because there
no,
are.
No, I think they supplement you guys because you're here every day with us.
I see. Okay. Well, most of those people are our mentors. You know, we stand on their shoulders. There are some new ones who have come along, but we're still having fun with it for sure.
Well, I appreciate you being there. Thank you. Can I ask, do you have time for another quick question?
We have time.
Unless there's somebody. I did see one of my natural providers today, and they said that the TIA looking response and vertigo looking response to what I had, they think is a pathogen. And so they did some body work and some allergy work with it. And finally, since the 26th, when I was in the emergency room, I have some energy and my head's more clear. So do you know pathogens that can cause that kind of response?
I personally don't. If we're talking about pathogens, in my mind, we're talking about parasites, we're talking about bacteria, we're talking about viruses. So if they think it's a virus like COVID or some other virus, people do have reactions to those sorts of infections. As the body fights them off, you get inflammatory response. And so, it's as good a guess as any, because you had your full workup on whatever else medicine has to offer. So if maybe some massage or moving areas, some manipulation that improves the lymphatic flow in your body. I've seen people who have improved with manipulation, either chiropractic or osteopathic manipulation. It has seemed to help some people. And so we don't necessarily understand the full science behind that. Acupuncture works sometimes and can really improve people's health. So if they helped you, that is wonderful.
And what particular, real quick, what are the strongest foods to eat to boost the immune system?
Well, just eating whole food, plant-based, as far as, because it's anti-inflammatory, because, there's not really, there are science of different nutrients and foods that boost different parts of the immune system. Like, there's a randomized controlled trial that showed this particular food boosted natural killer cells and things like that. And Dr. Greger's talked about those in his different videos, but one thing that he'll say about it is, it's like, well, you have to be careful about looking at studies that just seem to show that they improve one aspect of the immune system, but not another. And where, when sometimes we have, people get autoimmune diseases, or, a lot of times when, like with COVID, one of the reasons people get really sick with COVID-19 is they get what's called a cytokine storm, which what that is your immune system, basically your immune system that can kill people with COVID-19. So what's your immune system's overreacting to everything and kind of like dropping a nuclear bomb on one, say you have one rodent in a house that's in your house, and you, instead of just setting a trap for the rodent to get rid of the rodent, you drop a bomb on the house and destroy the house. You kill the rat, but then you destroyed your house. And so so you don't necessarily want to focus too much on certain aspects of your immune system so much, because that can, we don't really know if that's a good thing or not. So what we really look at is what's the way of eating and lifestyle that actually enhances your overall immune system. And that's, not eating meat and dairy and oils and processed foods, and getting good sleep and getting your exercise and reducing stress and having good social support, and all those six pillars of lifestyle medicine, all those together are going to be anti-inflammatory, are going to ensure that you have the maximum best immune system that you can have to fight an infection in an appropriate manner, rather than just having one part of your immune system being more robust than another. But just kind of more of a holistic look at it.
Thank you, Scott.
Yeah.
Well, we still have some more minutes, and we're We've done pretty good so far. Covered a wide range of topics. Anybody else have any burning questions on your mind? All you have to do is either unmute and speak up or raise your hand or whatever you want to do.
Next 2 weeks, we have pediatrician Eric Colgrove, Morgan Medical Group. He's going to be doing his two-parter on plant-based diets for pediatrics and families. So hopefully any of you that have kids or grandkids or nieces or nephews and you want to get a little focus, more focus on their nutrition and things you can do to help make some improvements in their nutrition, their diet, then it'd be a good class to attend next couple of weeks. And then later in the summer, Eric's going to do a pediatric obesity separate lecture on that too, because that was such a hot topic this past few months with the American Academy of Pediatrics coming out with their treatment guidelines for obesity, including weight loss medications and surgery for kids as young as 12. So, you know, which we, you know, it's bringing attention to it, which is good, you know, but we really need to focus on lifestyle medicine for these kids and families rather than just writing a prescription or cutting them open.
Don't do the surgery. It will mess you up.
Yeah.
I am a good example. I had a gastric bypass almost 15 years ago. And I lost 80 pounds, which was great. And as I think it was Nikki was saying, I was freezing all the time. I gained about 30 pounds back, which I'm still trying to get off. But I think the opening from my little pouch stomach into my intestines is stretched. So I don't have any sensation of fullness when I eat. I'm probably going to have to go back, and at least it's not a big surgery. They can endoscopically go in and tighten that back up. And I did ask to get my duodenum back because I have hypoglycemia really bad. I've had blood sugar as low as 23.
Wow.
Yeah, the doctor said, well, did you go to the hospital? I said, well, no, what? I mean, I don't know that much about it. I just felt sick. So I took my blood sugar and it was bad. So I got some juice and I was okay after that. But I really wish I'd never done it. I mean, it's not a good thing. And I wish I'd found this way of life a lot sooner. But I'm glad I'm here now. I'm working on it, trying to get my metabolism evened out and trying to keep my exercise up. And I've been doing this for almost 4 years, and I do feel a lot better, just overall health-wise. So don't put anybody through that stuff. It's not good.
Well, Linda, thanks for sharing that story. I think it's an important message for people to hear. I wish the American Academy of Pediatrics would have listened more closely to people like yourself before they recommend doing surgery for the 13-year-olds.
Yeah, I went back and talked to them about what was going on with me. And they said, oh, people get dumping. You know, you're not supposed to be eating sugar and cookies and stuff. And I said, I'm not eating that. I said, I know better. I mean, and when they make that little pouch of your stomach, you really can't throw up. So if you eat something that's sweet or not very good, you spend like the next 3 hours with a paper towel in the bottom of a wastebasket just spitting. It's awful. I would never do that to a kid.
Well, thanks for sharing. Sorry you've had to suffer that.
Oh, I'll live.
Okay, well, keep going. David.
Hello. One thing I wanted to share, I watched the Food Network Revolution stuff, or however you say that, And the one thing that I learned that I really didn't know anything about was the impact of the meat industry on the planet. And that was kind of a revelation to me. They had a lady who told a story that the kids in the high school, you know, they computed their carbon rating or whatever. And her son drove to school and the other kids rode their bikes and recycled and did all this stuff. Because he's a vegetarian, he got a lower score than all of them. Oh. That has more impact on the planet, apparently. But yeah, I didn't realize a lot of the information that they had on there about how bad it is. And our government will never change it. It just has to be all of us choosing to do something different.
We've been trying to share that message at the medical school with the med students and whenever we give talks to include the impact of environment on our environment of raising animals for our food source, that has to stop worldwide, actually.
If you stick around, we have a whole class on how our diet affects the environment. So we have a whole class dedicated to that later on.
Marcia, thanks, David. Marcia.
I was just going to ask what kind of surgery did Linda have when she was, that she said it was terrible?
It was a gastric bypass surgery.
Yeah. I've heard that can be.
I don't have my duodenum in my digestive tract, and that's what breaks down the sugars and stuff before it goes into your small intestines. So if I eat like crackers or bread or something, I remember when I was in high school, the teacher, our biology teacher, had diabetes, and he said, he passed around a sleeve of saltine crackers, and he said, put this in your mouth and just hold it, don't eat it yet. And he said, you know, this is the saltine, he said, but I want you to tell me what flavor you feel other than the salty. And we all realized that we could taste sweet, and your saliva will almost immediately begin to break that starch down and make sugar out of it. So sugar will go into your stomach and it gets sort of broken down before it goes into your intestines. But if I eat something like that now, it just goes into my stomach and right into my small intestines, and I get massively sick. It's bad.
Someone's asking about brewer's yeast, how much brewer's yeast is okay per day. I don't know that we regularly eat brewer's yeast. I think that's used for baking bread. There is a nutritional yeast, which I think you may be referring to. And the nutritional yeast, you can have, I think, several tablespoons a day. Depending on why you would want to eat that much, I don't know. We use nutritional yeast as kind of a flavoring for tofu, as I mentioned, that my wife makes. Sometimes nutritional yeast can be used, put on popcorn to give it kind of a cheesy-like flavor. And some people, if it has vitamin B12 in nutritional yeast, some nutritional yeast has vitamin B12 added to it. If you take it three times a day, you may be able to get your vitamin B12 that way, as opposed to taking a supplement. But I think you have to take about 2, 4, maybe 6 tablespoons a day. It's a lot. And I think Gregor went over it in one of his videos. So I would do a search on nutritionfacts.org for nutritional yeast and listen to a couple of the videos so you get a better idea for yourself. And using a salad dressing seems like a reasonable thing. Arun.
Good evening, Charlie. Let's see, I have comments on nutritional yeast.
Okay.
I've been using it for the last 10, 12 years, maybe more. And I was under the impression that it's good for having B12. But I know I like the test, so I put it in the cereal, you know, the oatmeal that we cook in the morning, or salads, or, you know, any cooked vegetables or whatever. So, you know, and I don't think we eat more than 2 or 3 spoons of it a day. So we probably are not getting enough B12 out of that. However, I do take B12 for the last year or so.
Well, then you're okay. But I think, as I recall, I don't remember exactly how much Gregor said, but he said it was quite a fair amount of nutritional yeast that you need to get your adequate supply, and it needs to be spread out throughout the day because you can only absorb so much at a time.
Right, yeah, and I think we do spread it out, you know, from breakfast till supper. I mean, it's a little bit in every meal. And it tastes really good if you put it on brown rice, for example, or if you put it on vegetables or on salads, like you said. So, yeah, it's a good test.
Well, thanks for
sharing. Instead of butter.
Thanks for sharing that. Anyone else? Notice my room is getting a little darker here, standing in the dark. We had our room, Stanley Steemered on the carpet. And so my usual space has been taken.
I have one more question.
Go ahead, Arun.
Thank you. So recently we discovered sesame milk instead of soy milk, you know, sesame milk.
Yep.
And it tastes awfully good. I wonder if you have any comments about sesame milk.
I've never had it. Anybody else? Have you had sesame milk?
I haven't.
I haven't, but have you looked at the ingredients in it?
Oh, I kind of have. I think it says no added sugar and 8 grams of protein or something like that in it.
Yeah, but what's actually in it? A lot of the plant milks you buy in the store have oil and all sorts of stuff in them.
I make
my yogurt out of soy milk, but I buy the stuff that's just soy and water, organic soybeans and water.
Right.
And you have to be real careful to look at what's actually in that milk, because I'll bet you there's a bunch of oil in it, and that's why it tastes really good.
You got a point. I will put a big magnifier glass and see what's in there.
And yeah. give us a report next time. We're curious.
Okay, will do. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, Ken.
I just heard you say something. I heard you say salad dressing is a good choice. Did you mean the salad dressing you make with the balsamic vinegar? Or is there some other salad dressing I'm missing?
No, the balsamic vinegar alone is a good salad dressing.
Okay, and then I just met a guy at the grocery store talking about this stuff, and he told me something that really is good. So the peppercini peppers, they come with a lot of juice, and that's really good salad dressing. So I eat lots of peppercinis now and use the juice with a little vinegar for salad dressing.
Does that have a lot of salt in it? Salt. What's the salt level in there? Check it out. While Ken's doing that, anybody else have anything they want to contribute for the good of the order?
Here he You're always raining my parade.
Okay. Yeah, well.
I have a question for Linda.
Yeah, go ahead, Marcia.
Linda, where do you find the soy, the milk, soy, and water, just water at?
Trader Joe's has it. It's called Soy Beverage. It's $2.29 a quart. If you go to Market of Choice, they have Pacific Soy Milk. You have to watch because right next to it is Pacific Ultra Soy Milk, which has all the oil and the other crap in it. But it'll probably cost you between $4 and $5 for a quart at Market of Choice. So I don't recommend going there. It's really hard to find things that don't have all the garbage.
I'm gonna raise my hand.
Sorry, Susan.
Okay, thanks, Linda. I wanted to say that Whole Foods has it for $2.99 for a half gallon. None unsweetened soy milk, just soy and water.
Oh, that's good.
Okay.
Thank
you.
Yeah, oh, never mind. It went out of my head.
Okay. So while Ken is still circling the room, Lisa, do you have, I don't know if you can talk or not tonight, but we'll get back with you, Ken.
I'm still a little numb here from my wisdom tooth surgery, so I smile a little crooked and talk a little weird, but we're getting better.
Well, it's good to see you.
You too, and everyone else here. I don't have anything in particular. I just wanted to say hi. I'm on my integrative medicine rotation in Agora Hills in California, so today was my second day. Lots of fun and interesting things, definitely different medicine than I've seen in my other rotations. So getting to learn a lot.
Well, that's good. Look forward to hearing some stories as time goes on. Okay, Ken.
I do get excited when I find something new that might taste good. And I don't know what I was thinking because, you know, I quit eating pickles. Because of the salt. And yeah, you're right. About 390 milligrams of salt for three little pepperoncinis. Darn it. Good thing I like vinegar, guys. Mm-hmm. I tell people, they say, how can you eat so many plants? I say, if you like salsa, hot sauce, and vinegar, you're going to love plants.
Oh, that's great. Another awakening.
Man, I eat a lot of plants and a lot of beans.
Beans and greens. If you add some greens to the beans, you'll really be healthier.
Well, I have your attention.
Yes.
I think I can quit Prilosec. I've been on omeprazole for years. I think it might have saved my life because I got that Barrett's. About 30 years ago.
Yeah. And
then I took Nexium for years, until just a few months ago. And I think it stopped the Barrett's from growing. It hasn't grown in all in 30 years. But the point I want to make is this. I don't know why. I eat a lot of tomatoes, which I would think would give me heartburn. I drink three cups of coffee in the morning. And I just don't get heartburn. And I thought I needed Nexium, but there's something about not eating cured meats. That's what I think.
Well, I don't know. If I were you with the knowledge that I've gained over the last 10 years, I would say, if you have Barrett's esophagus, there is some increased risk associated with that. Of cells becoming sort of overgrowing and becoming problematic. And before I completely quit, I would discuss this with the GI specialist and consider taking a look to make sure you don't have the Barrett's esophagus now, since you've been eating this way for so long, and that it would be safe for you to just stop the medicine.
Yeah, I told my PA that we'll cut it in half, which has been very successful. So I'm only having 10 milligrams, and I'm not getting any heartburn. So I've got an appointment in a month to see my gastro doctor. And we're
talk it over. We'll be curious to hear what he says.
Yeah, because generally you have to wean really slowly off of those medicines, the omeprazole or the Nexium, you know, the PPIs we call them. Sometimes you got to wean really slowly, and maybe to the point where you would take, even if you're on 10, maybe take 10 every other day or every third day, because a lot of times people, when they stop abruptly, they'll actually get a lot worse heartburn symptoms. So it's, you got to kind of wean off of it pretty slowly.
Thank you, guys.
Hey, it's been fun. Let's see, we've gone over our 5-minute time limit here. We don't really have a time limit, but we can't stay up all night. And anyway, if we talk too long, then you wouldn't have any questions for us as the weeks go by. Would that be possible, mm-hmm. Scott?
Lisa, hasn't happened in 3 years. Yeah.
So we're still having fun, and we continue to look forward to seeing you all next week again. And next week again, remember the pediatrician, Eric Colgrove. Be fun to listen to him. Look forward to meeting with you all next week.
I hope you guys can all come next week.
Take care.
Have a good one.
Bye.